Welcome to satsang. Welcome to inquiry. Welcome to the first step, which is conceptual clarity. Okay? Which makes it possible to take the second step, which is being in the presence of 100% assurance of reality, which opens up the way to the third step, is choosing a new idea, the idea of not trying to be prime creator, which gives rise to unconditional love, the experiencing of a perfect overlay of existence. If we don't take the first step, how can we get to the second step or the third step, right? There are some who think they're going to just jump, skip the first two steps, jump right into choosing a new idea. It's like the tortoise and the hare. The tortoise and the hare fable is that the rabbit, the hare, is always bragging and saying, I don't need to spend time on steps one or two. I can just jump right to the finish line. Whereas the tortoise is busy doing step one, conceptual clarity. And then the tortoise gets into eventually step two. And then eventually the tortoise takes step three. Where's the hare and all this? The hare's back there still bragging about how it's going to jump straight into step three. Hare never jumps into step three. So be the tortoise. What we're doing here is being the tortoise. Step one, conceptual clarity. Super important, all important. That'll get you to step two. Why? It'll set step two into the proper context so you won't be at odds with it. To be able to flow with it, it'll say, I get it. Conceptually, there won't be any resistance. And then you give all your focus, all your attention onto step two. For instance, step two would be like those who went to see Ramana Maharshi and just sat there quietly with him, day after day, month after month, however long, sometimes years, just sat there very quietly. That's step two. That's getting this perfect reassurance from an ambassador of reality, of truth, that this existence, this dream of existence, this belief system of existence has no consequence to reality whatsoever, has no consequence to our identity whatsoever. And just radiating that perfect assurance, and you simply, step two is simply to feel that reassurance. Let it sink in, sink in, sink in, sink in, which makes step three then very easy, choosing a new idea. But how do we get to step two if we don't take step one? How can we walk if we don't crawl? How can we run if we don't walk? See, so first we crawl, then we walk, then we run. So be the tortoise. Put in the effort. Put in the effort to conceptual clarity, which is what we're doing here on this satsang, these videos. And I think there's a 200 plus now of these videos, and they all advance the narrative to move your comfort zone, from believing that the existence is consequential to believing it's not consequential. And yet that's still belief, isn't it? So it's really moving the comfort zone to going beyond belief, because 100% certainty is beyond belief. So we've moved our comfort zone within belief, within concepts. And now step two is the point where you go beyond belief to 100% certainty, which belief cannot believe in. Belief believes everything is changeable, including reality, including perfect knowing, perfect certainty, that it's imperfect because it's changeable. So belief cannot believe in 100% certainty. Cannot. So that's where you have the going beyond belief. You step beyond belief when you come in contact with 100% certainty, whether that be internal or external. Sometimes that 100% certainty puts on a meat suit body and is here visible to the senses in this world. Sometimes that happens. Other times it doesn't happen. And internally we come in contact with 100% certainty. That's step two. Once we get used to stepping beyond belief into 100% certainty, then we can choose a different idea altogether. The idea of not trying to be prime creator gives rise to unconditional love, completely steady, stable, experiencing every single moment without any effort, effortlessly. That's step three. At that point, you are then an ambassador of reality, at that point. And then you radiate 100% assurance, effortlessly. But right now, our job step two is to get used to that 100% certainty, get used to that which is beyond belief. There's a period of getting used to it, getting familiar with it, which is super important. Right now, we're familiar conceptually with going beyond belief. And then the next step is to actually experience 100% certainty, which is beyond belief, and get used to that, move our comfort zone to that. And then after that, it's easy to choose a new idea. We can move our comfort zone right there, choose a new idea, and experience 100% certainty every moment, seamlessly, effortlessly. So right now we are concerned with step two. Step three is need not concern us at all at this point. Only step two. Going from step one to step two. Doing the two-step web. Step one to step two is right in front of us. It does concern us right now. Can we get enough conceptual clarity so the context for step two is there and we can step beyond belief and recognize what that is for, and that we merely need to get used to that, get comfortable with it, get familiar with it. And with our conceptual ducks all lined in a row, understanding all of that, then it's simple to then just get used to this 100% certainty. That's what devotees are doing with Ramana, is simply very advanced. Those who have done step one come to step two, and they just sit there and just get used to it. Just get used to it. There is a getting used to that, and it's beyond belief. It does not engage belief. It cannot engage belief, because belief cannot believe in it. So you have to put your belief on the back burner. You know, just let it sit there and don't try to do anything with it. And just get used to this grace, this 100% certainty. So we are getting comfortable with that, just not trying to do anything with belief, realizing that, you know, conceptually, that belief, what belief really is all about. That's what these videos have laid out very clearly, what belief is about. The more we can accept that, the more we're okay with that, realize we don't have to do anything with belief. You know, it's a waste of time. What we need to do is get familiar with that, which is beyond belief. Step two. So, we are certainly expecting step two at some point, somehow. Either there will be someone in the world who can give us step two, or one of us will be able to do step two, or it will come internally, step two. Those are three basic options. I don't know which one is going to be in play at this time. However, step two is important. Step one is just a precursor to step two. Have to go beyond belief. Otherwise, we will be caught up in judging belief. Which belief do we go with? Instead of stepping beyond belief itself. Because belief itself, the root of it, as has been pointed out in previous videos, is the desire to change reality, which means belief starts out as the belief that reality can be changed, meaning it's not permanent, meaning it's not stable. That is the premise upon which belief rests. That's its origin of belief. And belief is, of course, true to its origin, and yet it believes it can change its origin. Okay, so it's insane. It's completely insane. It's the belief that our origins can be changed and that nothing, reality is not reality. Because in reality, there's a direction from Prime Creator to the extension of Prime Creator. Okay, and there's not a reciprocal relationship. It's not that the Prime Creator is an extension of the extension of Prime Creator. No, it is not that way at all. So belief believes that it can change its origins, which is not true. It cannot. That it can change the idea that the purpose that it serves, it cannot change that. But it believes that it can. So belief is entirely slippery. You know, it insists that it can't be pinned down, that it's completely flexible, and yet it is not. It's completely rigid. completely rigid. But it can continually make up, make believe, of course, but it's completely set in its design and its purpose. It cannot change that, even though it believes it can. So we've pointed that out over and over and over. So belief will be sitting on the back burner saying, how come you're not, you know, I got something better for you. I got something better for you. I can change the your origins. And we say, no, you cannot change. And why would we want to change your origins? Because our origins are perfect, are flawless, and are infinite delight, perfect freedom. You can't have anything better than that. We already have that. So we have to stop listening to belief. Put it on, you know, hold. The belief calls us on the phone and we say, I'll be with you a little later. Put you on hold. Click on hold. Which reminds me, I need to put my phone on. Vibrate instead of ring. So put your phone to direct line to belief on vibrate or silent mode. Okay, so when it calls, you can just say, you know, not now, not right now. We'll get into all those details you want later, because belief wants you to explain what is beyond belief. It says, you got to explain it to me. I mean, okay, now how do you get that? How do you do that? You know, that's just a trick. It's just a trick to move you back into belief, into where it's comfortable, its comfort zone. As soon as you start using words and language with belief, you're in its comfort zone. Because language, words are subject to interpretation. They're subject to belief. Words are not a direct experiencing. So belief says, okay, now we can talk. See, that's why the best teaching is done in silence. Reassurance can be done in silence. Because there's no mediating filter of words which depend on belief, which depend on interpretation, right? Which is belief. Prime Creator did not create words, did not create some ambiguous subject to interpretation filter between the Prime Creator and its creations. It's direct knowing, direct experiencing. No words required. Communication is in reality is not based on words. It's based on direct knowing, isness. Perfect. No possibility of any ambiguity whatsoever or any interpretation. None. So belief simply wants to talk about it. Wants to talk about it. And when you put belief on the line, you know, belief is going to... It's got you. It's got you. Because now... You say something, belief says, no, wait a minute, I don't quite understand, you know, do you mean this by that, or this by that, or this is what I think you mean by it, or this, I believe you're trying to get here, and you can say, no, I'm trying to go here. Well, before you know it, you're all entangled in frustration and illusion and the interpretations of belief. Remember, we're going beyond belief. Certainty is beyond belief. Belief does not believe in certainty. In fact, it believes certainty is an illusion, a delusion. So it thinks it's doing us a favor. Truth is that when we are in certainty, belief thinks that we've gone temporarily insane, and believing that it is our guide and the authority over our lives, it believes that it must rush in and save us from this terrible insanity that we've slipped into. And so it will try to engage us in a dialogue of some sort. Just a minute. Okay, the mail has been delivered. So, an ambassador of reality is not attempting to get us to engage in a dialogue. If sometimes words arise, that's fine, but there's no desire on their part for us to engage in a dialogue, because they're already 100% certain, and they know that words bring uncertainty inherently. Words bring uncertainty. So it interjects a sense of uncertainty into the situation. There can be practical use of language, of course. You know, could you please adjust the microphone? Could you got this set up? Are we taping now? Everybody get comfortable and you know, We're going to take a break now. And of course, those are simply practical uses of language to, but as far as trying to say, what do you mean? I don't understand what you mean, or the meaning, etc. 100% certainty is the meaning. It's there already. So it's not a question, I don't understand what you mean. It means I'm not comfortable with 100% certainty. And then that can be clarified. But it's not the best thing to engage in a dialogue, because what you're doing is you're putting belief front and center and making belief, instead of you, spirit, there, you've now put a proxy and saying, this is what I really am, this belief. And you need to convince belief of what you're saying. Belief is not convincible. You cannot convince belief of 100% certainty. You cannot. But what we are, which is spirit, can be convinced, because we can experience it. Whereas belief cannot experience it. It's like darkness cannot experience light. Where there's light, there's no darkness. Where there's certainty, there's no belief. Okay, where there's belief, there's no certainty. So you cannot bring certainty into belief, where belief will vanish. It's not there anymore. Cannot do it. So as we're attempting to say, here, convince belief of this, we might say, well, I get it, but this belief doesn't get it. Can you convince this belief? You cannot. You cannot do that. It's not possible. It's like saying, I want this darkness to seem light, but I want it to still be dark. And you cannot do that. You cannot do that. So here's a hummingbird, red-headed. Let's listen. Okay, it took off. Maybe it'll be back. So if we're simply quiet and stop trying, belief is pestering us, saying, ask them this, ask them this, ask them this. I don't understand, pestering us. Come on, come on. Convince me. I need to be convinced. Because belief, again, feels a threat to belief. And it pretends to be interested like a spiritual devotee. Belief pretends. It's a pretense. It's not interested. It feels that it's being threatened, and it believes you are an offspring of belief. You're a child of belief, and that if belief disappears, you will disappear. So it believes it's saving itself and saving you by interjecting confusion into the situation. So as it tells you, ask this, ask that, and that is really, it's trying to confuse the situation, to save you from disappearance, from annihilation. But you are not a child of belief at all. So there is no threat to what you are. And belief is nothing. So how can nothing be threatened? Okay? Cannot. Belief is just a belief that it's something. But there's nothing, there's no identity there. There's nothing real there at all. So how can nothing real be threatened? It's nothing in the first place. It's zero. How can you threaten zero? But it believes that it's not zero because we have a desire to be able to threaten reality. And it's just the expression of that desire. But we cannot. So it's expression of really nothing, futility. So there's no threat there, no actual threat. Putting belief on the back burner is the skill set that is required to take the second step. Because once words start coming up and there's a belief jumps into the picture as a proxy, as you saying, hey, I'm a child of belief, and so in order to help me, you have to convince belief, then you don't have you're at odds with the situation. Belief is inherently at odds with the situation. So ability to not be concerned with the gibberish that belief is, throwing up, just sort of tune it out, put it on hold. It's on the line, but it's on hold. We understand that. We get a call, and we're on the phone with someone, and get a call come in, we hit it and say, can you wait, I'm on the other line, and click, they're on line two. Just let belief wait on line two for a while. And when you come back to it, belief will say, you kept me waiting. I said, I was busy. I was enjoying the situation I was in. Belief definitely feels very, very threatened if you are in any situation where your intention's really engaged beyond belief. You know, belief jumps in and says, starts asking questions, details, to get you out of that holistic state that you're in. Like, when did you arrive here? How long have you been here? You know, all these, you know, details get you out of that. Belief will jump in and say, it thinks up questions for you. Can you describe how you're feeling? You know, how long you've been feeling this? How did this situation arise? You know, let me need the background for this. Whatever it gets you out of it, the belief will pepper you with these questions. And what you need to say is, not right now. I'm really engaged, fully engaged with this, and we'll get to those details later. Yeah. That's how to handle it. I'm fully engaged with this right now. We'll get to those details sometime later. Just put it on the back burner like that. You have to keep doing that. Keep doing that. That's what meditation is supposed to be, is put belief on the back burner, practicing doing that. But in meditation, belief will let you do that because you're not dealing with 100% certainty in meditation. When you come across that which is 100% certain, that's when belief feels very threatened. Very, very threatened. And it will create crises and dramas and demands of you know, get shift things out of that 100% certainty. So we have to keep working on a skill set, how to do that. These videos here, they don't have the dialogue of like a satsang with an audience. So this is actually more helpful in a lot of ways, more helpful. Because you can't talk back, so belief, you know, can't do anything. It says, I want to ask questions. I want to question this thing. Let me question this. That's not helpful at all. It's not helpful. Because what questions you get demanding answers, verbal answers, that's putting belief front and center, which is not what we're trying to do. We're trying to put belief in the background. And not answer its questions. Don't entertain its questions. It's very tricky because it'll start out what seems to be a very reasonable question. But then that one, A, leads to B, and before you know it, you're off in the forest of confusion. And then you get all, your whole mind is whirling around like, how do I convince this belief? Answer, you cannot. So why start out on a journey that cannot be completed? Why? And it's only will be confusion and misery and suffering and feeling of miscommunication, and it's not working. It doesn't work. There's no clarification that can will work for belief, that give it 100% certainty. None. It's impossible. But that clarification, clarification doesn't work for belief, that is helpful. For what we are, we're not a child of belief. So it's helpful to stop believing we're a child of belief, to disengage from that belief. We have to do that, to disengage from the belief that we're a child of belief. When we come across that which is 100% certainty and we're accepted by that, then we say, oh my gosh, we're not a child of belief, we're a child of this 100% certainty. belief insists that we will not be accepted by 100% certainty because we're a child of belief. It tells us that. So we're afraid to come across these ambassadors of reality, ambassadors of certainty. We feel they will reject us because they will say, well, you're a child of belief. You're not a child of 100% certainty. So there's this distance between us, and we have different origins. So we feel with this feeling of different origins. This is not true. All life has the same origin, 100% certainty. So you will be accepted by 100% certainty as the same origin. Same origin. That is what we have to look forward to, is acceptance, which will be very surprising to us. Surprising to belief. And since we're used to believing, we're a child of belief, certainly we will whoa, how come we're being accepted? That's amazing. And we all have this trouble. I mean, if I imagine coming across an ambassador of certainty, I still say, will I be accepted? There's still that uncertainty about it. Not really sure at all. Because we're so used to believing we're a child of belief that there's still that vestige of maybe it's true. Because we've done it for so long, we think maybe it's taken root. It's like we've been watering this plant for so long. We're thinking maybe it's put down some roots. But the truth is, it's a plastic plant. It doesn't have any roots. But we're not certain about that. So we do have to go through this epiphany of being accepted by certainty, which will be a kind of blow our minds. It will just like, wow, it will be a major, major event. Because we're not sure that we would be accepted by certainty. Now, on the inner levels, I've been through that, but externally, I've not been through that. Not many have. Why do we not have this ambassador of certainty here? Or at least not many, or maybe none, maybe some, I don't know. Because we are afraid that we won't be accepted by them. And therefore we want to say, keep your distance. We're not ready yet. We're not ready. We haven't found a way to convince belief that this is helpful. That just shows we believe we're a child of belief, and we need to convince belief of whatever it is that we come across. We have to convince belief of that it's okay, that belief is our parent, so to speak, and we have to convince the parent. We want to spend time with this 100% certainty, and belief is saying, no, not yet. What belief is really believing is that, this one is still insane, has attraction to insanity. I need to work with them more, and they need to go through some certain sacrifices and trials and tribulations and lessons to break this attraction to certainty. That's what belief really is believing. So it's not a good thing that we don't have this ambassadors of certainty. Because belief is working on us, trying to get us, free us from our attraction to that. And that's not a good thing at all. What we need to do is we need these ambassadors of certainty. We need to get with it. We need to realize that they accept us, and then we don't realize we don't need to convince a belief of that at all. And get with that. And to do that, we need to consciously raise this to our conscious awareness. That this is the trouble. We're uncertain if they will accept us, if we'll be accepted by certainty. The quality of ambassadors of truth is certainty, and that is what belief absolutely dismisses. I remember I used to have that quality, and to a certain extent, and people believe this world would not accept it. I was certain of things. I was absolutely certain. And they'd say, no, you can't be certain. And they say, no, I'm certain. I know this is it. And they say, no, you cannot know it. You can't be certain. You can only believe it. So what you mean is you believe this will take place, or believe this. And they just, after getting hammered for, 12 years, I finally slipped more into belief than certainty, which then caused, innumerable troubles. If someone says, I know this, I'm 100% certain, the world belief will just say, you're crazy, you're insane, you're making it up, etc. That is a fact. And anyone who's been in this world can attest to that fact if they're honest about it. The world does not accept absolute certainty, 100%, without the slightest possibility of it being otherwise. Total certainty does not accept it. It says, no, it's not possible. Such a thing is impossible. To belief, it is impossible, because belief can never experience 100% certainty. Cannot. So to belief, it is impossible. But we are not a child of belief. To us, it is possible. That's our native home. That's what we are, is 100% certainty, 100% inclusion, without any conditions whatsoever. We are included in reality, perfect inclusion. Reality is perfect inclusiveness, without any possibility of being excluded. Nothing real can be excluded from reality. If we want to have exclusion, we can only dream of it, only believe in it, but it cannot make it real, cannot make exclusion real. So we're very comfortable with 100% certainty, but to believe it's impossible. Belief says, that is an impossibility, it can never happen. Now, it can never happen to belief. Yeah, that is true, it can never happen to belief. But we're not a child of belief, so we don't need to make it happen to belief. See, we're trying to get 100% certainty through belief, believing that belief is our origin, and we're a child of belief. Therefore, in order to get that 100% certainty, we have to somehow find out a way for belief to get it 100%, and then through belief, we will then receive 100% certainty. That's the trouble we're having, and that's impossible. Cannot be done. We have to realize we are not a child of belief. Therefore, we don't need to have belief get 100% certainty. We don't, in order for us to experience it. We do not. So when we have an experience of 100% certainty, then we engage belief again. We think the way to help others is somehow we have to get belief to believe in our 100% certainty, so then the others who believe their children belief can get it. That is impossible. That is futile. That is not the way to teach it. It's absolutely futile. But belief believes, everyone here in the world believes that is the way. Like, okay, we have 100% certainty, and everyone will believe, okay, if you can get, you have to get belief to believe it, and then we'll all get it too. That will never happen. Will never happen. It's a complete futile waste of time to do that way. The way to teach is to recognize that we are not a child of belief, which is then important to realize, where did belief come from? How did it arise? Why is it arising? To realize that we're the ones that gave rise to belief. Okay? And then we realize we are not a child of belief, therefore we don't need 100% certainty to go through belief in order to reach us. And then we can set that belief aside and experience 100% certainty. So by bring all this up to conscious awareness and talk about it like we're talking about it, just sharing clarity like this, you start to get it. You start to say, aha, no wonder that we've been tricked thinking we have to somehow help. The way to help others is first we have to convince belief of certainty. No wonder why there's been this roadblock. No wonder why it hasn't worked. No wonder why we've had all these troubles. Been going about it the wrong way. And therefore we realize, okay, what is the correct way? Set belief aside, go beyond belief. Stop trying to convince belief of anything, of certainty. Of course, practically we can still function in the world, but we're not trying to convince belief of certainty. and those who insist that they're children of belief, and the only way you can help them is to convince belief, they're not ready for teaching, not ready for truth. They are still engaged in demands of belief, and they cannot be reached that way. So there's really nothing you can do except to just let their demands go unanswered, let those phone calls go unanswered, put those phone calls on block, you know, because it can't work that way. You know, it's a waste of everybody's time and effort. And after a certainty, you know, leaves this world, an embodiment of certainty leaves this world, and then belief will work with that. And everyone who believes in belief will, that they're a child of belief, they will say, well, this great avatar, savior, guru, sage, you know, prophet, you name it, they somehow convinced belief 100%, or they moved it closer to 100%, and we just have to wait. There's some process working now that will bring this 100% certainty to belief, and we just have to wait for that process to finish. That's how they'll spin it, in some way like that, which is, again, futility. They'll be waiting for something that can never happen, waiting for something that can never happen to happen, to get that certainty through belief. It will never happen. Never. You can have trillion saviors in the world, they will never bring certainty to belief. Never. There's no process that will make that happen. None. So this type of waiting is futile. The waiting for certainty through belief is completely futile. The more you get that sense of that, the more you start moving towards what really works. Getting certainty through certainty. Certainty is not the product of a process. Certainty is always, reality's always been certain of itself. It didn't have to arrive at certainty somehow. It's always been there. Certainty is certain that it's not excluding anything. Okay, there's no exclusion. Reality includes all of reality, is perfectly included in all of reality. Perfect inclusiveness. It's always certain of that. No doubt. There's never any doubts about it. Never any doubts about it. So what we're doing here is we're setting up the right context for a boost, for a step two to happen, to occur here, to make benefit, to make use of it, right use of it. By not trying to channel it through belief to help others, that will then take us away, and we'll be lost to the situation if we think, oh my gosh, I've got certainty, now I can go out and give others certainty by convincing belief, you know, of it, and then now they'll get it too. No, you only will cause yourself to go back into delusion, because you'll be working with belief then, trying to convince it. One of those ambassadors of reality, Ananda Mayama, when people would ask questions of her, that she would be silent, and someone might say something, and most of the time she wouldn't reply at all. She just remained silent. Sometimes she would say, if really pestered, she would say, nothing occurs to me, no response is occurring to me to this question at this time. That's what she'd say. There's no responses coming to me to this question. And then it'll go back to being silent. Because if the context of the question was to, how can we convince belief of the certainty you have, she would say, there's no responses occurring to me at this time. And then silent. So there's never any traction to get it going there. But if you ask something that was based on going beyond belief, then she, some response would occur, and then she'd talk, say something, and get into that. So it's not like couldn't talk. It's just that when the motive behind the question is, how do we convince belief of this, you know, then she would just, you know, say, there isn't, basically saying there isn't any way. There's no response I can give to that which will satisfy you, which will work. Then silence. Silence is the response to belief. In other words, don't engage with belief. Don't try to convince belief. Certainty doesn't require words. Doesn't need to convince belief. Certainty doesn't need to convince belief that it's certain. It does not. Because certainty doesn't need belief to be certain. Certainty belief is not some co-creator of reality. Okay. We cannot substitute belief for what we are and say the prime creator, we're no longer the spirit co-creator. Now this belief is now in our place, and now that is the co-creator, and you have to deal with this belief. No, we can't do that. We cannot do that. So, we don't need to convince belief of anything. We don't need to convince belief of certainty. When we choose a new idea, the idea of not trying to be prime creator, no more belief. No more belief. Belief is replaced by certainty. We just have unconditional love, which is inclusiveness. We feel that inclusiveness, the equal overlay, equal simultaneously, equal quality, equal quantity, and unchangingness, that is there, that perfect inclusiveness, without any flaws or effortless, we will experience that instead of belief. Because belief in that is not stable. It is not inclusive. It is insisting that what is excluded from what is. That certainty, perfect certainty, is excluded. There's something that has to be excluded from that to make it imperfect. So it's not perfect inclusiveness anymore, is it? From the standpoint of belief, not at all. That's the premise. That's the starting point from all belief, is no such thing as perfection. No such thing as that which cannot be changed. No such thing as perfect certainty. No such thing as facts. That's the starting point, the premise of all belief. So no matter what belief is asking, it's coming from that standpoint. Absolutely is. And of course, belief believes it can change its premise. It cannot. Effects cannot change the premise that gave rise to them. It cannot. It cannot change the idea that gave rise to them. So belief always will come from that standpoint, that of exclusion. Something is excluded. Cannot be perfect inclusiveness. Cannot be unchangeable reality. Cannot be facts. It comes from that premise always, without exception. It will always be that way. So with that in mind, it gets easier to put belief on hold. It becomes easier. Become more willing to do so, which opens up step two for us, you see, which is to actually be getting that vibe of certainty, that vibe of certainty that is, you know, is tremendous. And that's what really, it sinks in deep. It seems it connects with depth, and there seems to be, you know, an infinite depth to that connection. You know, there's no disconnection. It's belief that's a disconnection. And so with that no disconnection feeling, that of inclusiveness, you know, that is profound. That is profound, and you can abide in that profundity. We can do that, but that's step two, and we have to get to step two first. And we deserve step two. 100% deserve it. But of course, belief says we don't deserve it yet. Belief will say, sure, we deserve it, but just not yet. That's why you hear people say, Jesus, come back, but just not yet, because we don't quite deserve it yet. What they're saying is, certainty, come back in my life. Certainty, I want certainty back in my life, but not yet, because I'm not quite deserving of it yet. That game goes on forever. Belief will play that game forever. Belief will say, of course we want certainty, of course, but just we're not quite ready yet. We're not deserving of it yet. That's this game. It's a game of delay. It's a game of delay. Belief is just treading water in a game of delay. That's all it does. It puts off certainty. All the while trying to undermine your attraction to certainty. All the while. And that undermining is very subtle, very tricky, very devious, very deceptive, but very vicious too. And that undermining is taking place constantly, every day. Belief is doing everything it can to undermine your attraction to certainty. And you're struggling to, you know, maintain that attraction to certainty. It's not easy. But it's very doable. It's very doable. You have to. We have no choice. We have to keep that attraction to certainty there. And we have to keep rapidly going towards step two. Eventually, where we in the presence of that certainty, where we're feeling that certainty very strongly. That no matter what our superficial words and thoughts are, the feeling of certainty is within us, and we're feeling that certainty. No matter what the play is that's going on, we're feeling that certainty, and we know it's effortless, and we don't have to do anything. It's not being generated by some action. It's by being generated by unconcern with any action. And belief will be trying to, you know, guide us somehow, saying, oh yeah, okay, now you got it, now you got to go do this, you know, this to keep it, or this to make it more, or this, that. It immediately tries to play the guide, you know. Belief believes that it is our creator, and that its role is to guide us, but what it's really trying to guide us away is from the attraction to certainty, offering some substitute for certainty that, you know, feels good, some feel-good substitute for certainty. Saying, this is better. This is even better. Now, there's nothing better than certainty, because certainty is how reality feels. There's no better feeling than certainty. Certainty is the feeling of inclusion, perfect inclusion. You know, and that feeling has an infinite depth to it, and we can gradually get used to that depth. It's like we go beneath the ocean. Let's say you're treading water on the surface of the ocean, and you decide to stop treading and go beneath the surface of the ocean, and suddenly you're aware of the depth of the ocean. When you're above the surface, you're looking, all you see is the surface. You don't know the depths. When you go below the surface, you look, and suddenly you see depth. You don't know, you know, how much the depth is, but you feel depth. Then if you just stay beneath the surface like that, you become more and more aware of the depth and get used to it and say, ah, this feels great. Ultimately, the truth is, there's endless depth. There's endless depth. But first, we get used to just a feeling that there is depth. Above the surface, we don't see depth. We just see the surface. That's belief. Belief just sees the surface. So we don't want to stagnate with just step one, clarification. Clarification can continue. But, you know, at some point, you know, like you can crawl forever. If you want to keep crawling, you can keep crawling and get somewhere. But at some point, you want to stand up and walk. So there's nothing wrong with crawling. It's you know, at a certain stage, crawling is great. It gets you the things you want. You see a toy over there. You want to get to the toy. You crawl over and you get it. It's like, ah, I got there. But when you walk, you realize, hey, I can get there faster, and I can get better stuff too. could get a lot better stuff. So we keep crawling and getting what, you know, getting to it. At the same time, also anticipating a time when we can start to walk. And looking forward to that. Not thinking about it too much, but just getting to the issues, the important key elements of the situation, which is what we're doing. We're doing it. I would say we're doing a great job here. You know, it's right on point, right on focus, right on target. These are the issues that we have in being able to walk, being able to be in the presence of certainty. There are these issues that arise about, you know, what do we do? What do we do? Or, you know, how do we get with this? How do we get benefits from it? How do we not get, you know, get off track and all this stuff? These are the issues. And why maybe there's some questions don't get responded to and others do. And, you know, just the whole situation is pretty simple. It's pretty simple. It's not complex. It's just this issue of belief and realizing we're not a child of belief. We don't have to convince belief of certainty at all. In fact, belief can never be a certainty. So therefore, all these questions that belief are asking us is really trying to distract us from certainty, because it believes that certainty is terrible for us, and it's trying to break that attraction to certainty. And it's trying, of course, can be very polite and artful in trying to do this, but that's its goal. And yet we know that it can never deliver anything that we really want, belief. So it's a waste of time to entertain belief. It's a waste of time. It gets us off track. And we believe that by engaging with belief, we can convince belief. And belief says, yeah, oh yeah, you can convince me. That is not true. That is a lie. So we have to keep this lie in mind. Central to the situation is belief believes it can change what it is. It can change its origins, that it can accept certainty. That is not true. That is a lie. And when we engage with belief, we're believing in belief. We believe we can change belief. We can convince belief of certainty, that we can get belief to accept certainty. We cannot. No one can. The Prime Creator cannot convince certainty, a belief of certainty. It's not possible. So if we know that, it's a futile lie, that we're accepting a lie in order to converse with belief, we're going to back off from it more and more and more. Say, whoa, wait a minute. This will go nowhere. We'll go nowhere. Because one, we can never lose our attraction to certainty. So that goes nowhere. Ultimately, it goes nowhere. Two, we can never convince belief of certainty. We never get belief to accept certainty. That goes nowhere. So the whole engagement with belief goes nowhere, never goes anywhere. So it's just from the very beginning, it's a waste of time, goes nowhere, absolutely nowhere. And yet we can believe it's getting somewhere because we believe that the goal can be reached. But if the goal can never be reached, how can you be getting anywhere? You cannot. You will see that the ambassadors of certainty don't entertain belief at all. And they just have this continuous certainty. Continuous. And you say, my gosh, they're not even engaging belief at all. Why, you know? Huh, that's really interesting. You start to ponder on that, you know. How is that possible? Why are they not engaging belief? What's going on here? Because they know. And we can know too, because it's a fact. And we're, reality is all inclusive. We're included in reality. We're included in facts. So we can know facts. We can know it. We don't have to get belief to accept the fact first, because we'll never accept facts. Belief will never accept facts. Belief can never accept what is, isness, but is, cannot, cannot, and this cannot be emphasized too much. It's really the satsang inquiry has to be right there on this fact. Over and over and over and over and over, so that we get used to looking right at this situation. The lie of belief that it can change the premise, change its purpose, that it can accept certainty. That is a lie. Belief can never accept certainty. Cannot, because it's the very purpose of belief is to insist that reality can be changed. That there's no such thing as 100% certainty. No such thing as facts. That gives rise to belief. Without that desire, belief cannot even arise at all. Would not arise at all. So to say that belief can have 100% certainty is a contradiction. 100% certainty doesn't give rise to belief at all. There wouldn't be any belief to accept certainty. You can either you can either be focused on belief or certainty. You can't have both. You cannot have both. Just like where you turn on a light in a dark room, you don't have the darkness anymore. You can't have both the darkness, a room full of darkness, and a room full of light at the same time. It's not possible. Even more so, you cannot have certainty and belief. Belief containing the certainty. No. Belief arises from the desire for no facts, for exceptions, for exclusions, for changes to reality. It arises from the desire for reality to be changed, for it not to be what it is. That's what gives rise to belief. And that desire comes from our desire to entertain, experience the idea of being prime creator. That's its origin. So ultimately, we're the ones who gave rise to belief. And it's just an effect. It's not a cause. The cause is our desire to change reality, to be prime creator, which means a change in reality. And that desire, that idea, the desire to experience that idea, which is with all ideas, we have a desire to experience them. That's fine. But it's this particular idea we desire to experience gives rise to belief, which means it's a denial of reality, belief that nothing is permanent. There's no such thing as permanence, no such thing as facts. But again, belief believes it can change this. It can change its premise, and it can accept certainty. Belief believes it, and you have to put your foot down and say, no, that's impossible. And so, but belief, will not agree with that. Will not agree with it. So, you cannot get belief to agree with you putting it on hold. It will not agree with that. It will just say, you're temporarily insane. You've gone into a little fit or some sort. So it's going to wait for you, But no, you cannot get belief to believe that it cannot change its purpose, its premise. Because to believe, everything is changeable. Everything. There are no facts. So to state a fact, to say, belief, you cannot change your premise, the purpose you're serving. You cannot accept certainty. You're expressing a fact to belief. And belief rejects facts. Okay? Rejects facts. Will not accept facts. So you just simply have to put belief on hold. Belief has to be put on hold. Permanently on hold until you choose a new idea, and then belief doesn't arise at all. See, when belief arises, belief believes it's the origin of no facts, and it believes you're a child of no facts too, which means the fact that you're a child at all is not a fact either, is it? So there's no permanent identity within belief, no stable identity whatsoever, none. And of course, belief keeps saying it can change that. No, it cannot, because it cannot never accept facts. Reality is a fact. The desire to change reality gives rise to belief. It is insisting that reality is not a fact. So belief serves that purpose, and so it will not accept facts. So when you say belief cannot turn you into a true identity, that's a fact. And belief will reject that, say, no, belief will succeed. We are not a child of belief. Belief cannot develop a stable identity, cannot come up with a stable identity. That's a fact, cannot do it. And again, belief rejects all facts, so it also rejects this fact. It insists it can come up with a stable identity for us. We just have to jump through all these hoops and put in the time, do the process. There's some kind of mantra that will achieve it, or something that will enable us to be accomplished. That's not true. The fact is, it can never come up with a stable identity. Cannot come up with anything stable, because it rejects facts, which means nothing is factual. So where is identity? What it tells us is changing identity is our identity. That's what it tells us, that the constant changing of our, changing us and variableness, all that, we're supposed to accept that as our identity. But of course, we're attracted back to our true identity, and so it tells us that the way we get this changeable identity to be happy with it is we have to figure out a way to get rid of this attraction to identity, to facts. And so our belief is constantly trying to teach us how to get rid of this attraction to facts, to real facts. In other words, facts about reality. The facts of reality, not empirical facts about measuring, this hologram, this dream hologram. Not facts about that. Those are just facts of measurement. We're talking about facts, reality. That the facts of reality is what we're talking about here. We're not rejecting practical facts of measurement. No, of course not. It's just that apples and oranges. We're talking about apples and, practical facts of measurement are oranges. There's no conflict there. There's no conflict at all. Belief will claim, oh, there's a big conflict. There's none. There's no conflict there. We're talking about real facts, facts of reality. Belief cannot accept those facts. And its insistence that it can is a lie. It's not true. It's non-factual. Or we can say it's a fact that is not true. Then again, there's another fact. Belief says, I don't know. No. Gotta be a way. I'll find it. Gotta be a way. There is no way. Belief is an effect that believes it's a cause. The cause of no facts. But no such thing as no facts. Reality is factual. You can't cause any, reality to be non-factual, non-real. You cannot cause that. How can an effect cause that? It cannot. But it can be believed in. This type of sharing here is something that an ambassador of truth would smile upon, say, yeah, this is good inquiry, this is good satsang, this is good focus, this is right focus, right satsang, right inquiry, this is right on track. So it's not distracting away from step two at all. It's segueing into step two by facing belief right at its root. Okay, right at its root, and not all off on some other tangent, which belief is desperate to get off on a tangent, desperate to deflect us away from our attraction to certainty. It tries to get us off on a tangent, but the capacity to bring it back to right to the root is what we call a teacher or sharing inquiry, an inquiry. It's not step two. It's step one inquiry, which prepares for step two, which is more abidance, which is more of a silent satsang. Now, step one and step two can be combined, but it's better. Step two is better if it's more silent. It's better. Whereas step one is better if it's clarification. We use words and talk about it. Combining the two, it becomes a little uneven and a little uncertain, because you get a lot of people who are there for just step one, and they don't get step two at all, and they want to move it, you know, all towards step one. And you get those who are there for step two, and they don't want to spend all this time listening to the step one stuff going on either. So for the way I see it, at least now, is that step one should and step two should not be combined. It's not ideal at all to combine the two. Ramana did not combine them, and Anandamayi did not combine them. They were giving us step two. And the step one did come to them, but they would be, you know, put in the sort of appropriate context, you know, maybe, you know, and it would not be, you know, the whole thing, the whole circus under one tent. That would not be taking place. Like Anandamayi Ma would be in a room, you know, and she'd invite, tell those who helped her to go bring so-and-so, and have a few people come in, and they would sit silently, something, you know, or she'd arrange for those who are ready for step two to have that. And then at times there'd be step one, there'd be people coming, you know, for blessing, you know, darshan, seeing and blessing and stuff, which is actually a step two. Darshan means the seeing of certainty, coming into contact with certainty, seeing it. Just, you know, even from afar, you see that which is certainty here. You see it, and it kaboom. So what is that? What is that? You know, it's just like if some exotic creature was, you know, walking down your street someday, and you know, it had 10 legs and was, you know, floating, and like kind of, and you just say, what is that? You know, what is that? Whoa, haven't seen that before. Darshan means coming to see certainty. Doesn't mean you have to stay there a long time or talk with it or anything. But oftentimes those in step one, or even those who want to get into step one, will get a glimpse of certainty. Then they'll know, certainty, you know, is real. You know, we haven't lost it. It's still here. And then they can get going with step one. Sometimes those in step one seeing step two, they can get ready for step two. So there is this principle of darshan, which is the seeing of certainty, without feeling that you need to engage with it. And the teachers did a lot of that. Anandamayi Ma did a lot of that. She even would go on train trips. Just a second. Where she'd be on the, you know, some of area of a train where it's open, you know, some type of open carriage, so to speak, of a train, and the train would go very slowly, and everybody in the countryside, the villages, would come where the train, you know, train the route of the train, and everyone would see her, could see her, and you know, she'd, you know, bless, you know, be blessing them, and sometimes tossing out flowers and prasad or food or something, and you know, and everyone would see. And that's a darshan, that's the seeing. And they'd see it, and they'd realize, oh my gosh, the certainty is still a fact. I just saw it. And then they'd say, wow, you know, maybe I need to get into inquiry here. Step one, right? And that way, you know, millions had darshan by just traveling on this train through the countryside. I think she did it in various places, but Western India, I think the ruler of Western India set it all up, changed all the train schedules, enabled this train to go real slowly, and maybe at certain stations it would stop, and the crowds would then see the embodiment of certainty, ambassador of truth. They get a glimpse of it. That's all it takes, is a glimpse. That's all it takes, because something in you says, wow, certainty lives, you know, There it is. I mean, certainty is still certain. It's still a fact. Facts are still facts. And it's just like, it's a game changer. It is a game changer. And then within you, you say, you know what? The belief doesn't believe in that. There's some problem here. I've got to straighten this out. I've got to get back to certainty. I'm attracted to it. The attraction to a certainty, you know, is ignited, reignited, gets stronger through darshan, through seeing of certainty. And then these teachers, these ambassadors of truth, have adjuncts, those who can give inquiry and satsang inquiry, like I'm doing right here, that help people with step one, help prepare for step two. Now, step two is different than darshan, where you're abiding in proximity to that certainty for prolonged periods of time, and you've got the right context. You understand what the ultimate goal is to choose a new idea, and then that's a whole different level. Okay, then darshan is like introductory to step one. Step one is the inquiry. Step two is abiding in the presence of certainty, and then step three is choosing a new idea. Now, all of this can be managed, but it does have to be managed appropriately. You cannot have those darshan, you know, taking over the situation. It has to be understood. It's a temporary measure. It's a glimpse. It's a glimpse. And they can't say, oh, come to my village. Stay with us. Stay in my house. I want you to come to my village. No, you know, go back to your village and begin inquiry. Build upon it, you know. And if there's, you know, there's someone in their village that might be able to help you with that inquiry. It's not the purpose of the ambassadors of truth to go to a village and remain there. That is not it. They do attend to those who, step two, those who are ready for step two. They are prioritized. Anandamayama prioritized those who are step two. Absolutely. The renunciates, those who are, have prepared inquiry for step two, front of the room, on stage with her, in proximity to her. She'd say, okay, you're in proximity. The others are a little, you know, distance, a little more distance away. But she insisted on that. Prioritize step two, prioritize. But helping stage one also by helping those who are helping out with stage one to keep their motivation strong, helping many get into stage one by darshan, by seeing a glimpse of the certainty. Doing all of that. That's how it works here. That's how it works. And trains are a great thing, really. I wish we were back in the age of just trains. Some cars, you know, bicycles and stuff, but definitely transportation via trains is very helpful because it can be used for that. It really can. With plane flight and stuff, you know, how can that be used? What we use now is bus tours, you know. And I guess you'd have a bus with an open carriaged bus or something, like a platform or something, and a bus could drive along. You need a police escort because you wouldn't be going fast, et cetera, et cetera. But, you know, theoretically it could be done. But trains really could work very well for that. Airplanes, of course, how can you do that? Just you bypass it all. You point A, one city, to another city, you know, bypass all the countryside in between. And most of the people, you know, in the countryside, you know, cannot just, they don't have this, you know, mobility of the rich to just go wherever they want to go. Or the train can go through the countryside, and people can just go to the train tracks and just line up the train tracks, and you got a train going along at, you know, at 5 miles an hour, and you got a chance, and you can even walk along. You know, the train is moving. You can walk along for miles if you want to and get this darshan of an appearance here by certainty in the world. Just, it's incredibly helpful. Incredibly helpful. Unforgettable. I've talked with people who had darshan of Anandamayama, and they said they're old now. They said they never forgot it. Changed their life. just a glimpse, it changed my life, totally changed it. Because why? Because they knew the certainty is still certain. It's a fact. And gave them leverage against belief, that monstrous bully of belief, that liar, you know, absolute liar and deceiver. Gave them leverage. They never forgot it. Just a glimpse. This is totally true. It's unmistakable because there's nothing else like it in existence. It's certainty. Where do you find certainty in existence? But then belief, you cannot find it. Only that which comes into existence from the grace of God brings the certainty as an ambassador of reality. And only there do you get certainty, or within your own, you have certainty within. That can also arise. You can have an experience from within where you become aware of certainty also. But as far as externally, no, you can't find it. You cannot find it. Another way is waterways. If you have waterways, extensive waterways, you can send a boat very slowly along the banks of all these waterways, and people can gather on the banks of these waterways and have darshan that way. That is also a very, very helpful way. Because the boat can just glide very slowly, very slowly. The Egyptians used to do that down the Nile. They had the pharaohs who would be in a boat, open boat, and they would go slowly along the Nile, and everybody would go to the banks of the Nile, you know, and see the Pharaoh. The Pharaoh representing something to them. I don't know if there were any embodiments of certainty in Egypt. I don't know whether there were or not. But the principle is the same, that you can take a boat down a waterway. And millions and millions, and I mean, just think about it. If you went down the Mississippi, you know, billions could be along the length of a Mississippi. You could put billions of people, really. There's no problem. I mean, you can line them up, you know, hundreds deep if you want to. An embankment, if there's an embankment on the waterway, you can just line the embankments, can be lined like they do on the Ganges, you know, they have people. There's all these ghats or steps along the river, and you can line those up with millions of people, and you can theoretically you can have a boat slowly go along there, and everyone can have darshan. Absolutely. And that spiritualizes, truly helps out the world immeasurably. Because it's a reassertion of certainty, and it's leverage against belief. It's a glimpse of certainty says, ah, it's still there. It hasn't been changed. It hasn't been affected. Belief hasn't changed it. It's still exactly the way I know it to be. Hasn't been changed. And it's like the most amazing epiphany. You know, you realize, oh my gosh, certainty is still certain. And it's a total game changer. And that comes from one glimpse of certainty brings that. And it's not overpowering, but it's deep. And then from that point, a real spiritual inquiry can develop from that point. The leverage is with you then. Just a glimpse of it. I had my glimpse internally in a dream. And also through videos of Ananda Mahima, I saw it too. I said, oh my gosh, the certainty. There's 100% certainty right there. And it hasn't changed. But initially I got it through a dream where I experienced perfect certainty. And then I knew that certainty hadn't been changed. It's a fact. Facts are facts and they don't change. And then the leverage to begin to put off belief began and really in earnest at that time. I had the tool, had the right, you know, the leverage to do it, to stand up to the bully. Before I knew the certainty was true, but I was bullied by belief, and belief was just bullied me so bad. But now I started to, you know, push back a little against that bully and saying, hey, you can't quite bully me so bad. That is really what it's like. It's like you're a little waif of a child, and there's some big, big bully, real meanest bully, and terrorizing you, you know. And but then you get a little strength, and you start be able to minimize the bullying a little bit, and you got gradually, you know, the bully becomes less intimidating. That's what it's like, really. That's really what it's like. I don't want to remember how it was, but I was just bullied by beliefs so terribly, because beliefs saw me as such a threat that it put everything possible to break the attraction I had towards certainty, and so just, you know, gave every kind of bullying effort it possibly could do, and just intimidated me horribly. Try not to dwell on those times, because those were not good times, for sure. But I know how bad belief can bully. It is 100% bully. It can be. It can seem to be very nice, right? Very nice. Nice senorita. You know, so kind and gracious and stuff. When it sees that you're not attracted to certainty, not very attracted, and trying to break that attraction, it then is very nice, very nice. But when it sees you started being attracted back to certainty, oh boy, it can be an absolute monster. A vicious monster. Of course, it believes it's all for your own good. So it totally justifies everything it does. It doesn't have any mercy. Why should it have mercy when it's everything it believes everything it's doing is for your own good, to save you? Why should it have any mercy? It doesn't have any compassion or mercy. Because it believes what it's doing is for your own good. The end justifies the means. So you cannot bargain with it or anything. You cannot get it to back off. The only way you get it to back off is you back off of your attraction to certainty. And then it will, you know, back off. But if you don't back off your attraction to certainty, it won't back off. So then you have no choice but to stand up to it. Start getting the tools to stand up to it. No choice. It's either that or back off of your attraction to certainty, which is a waste of time, because you can never back off it entirely. It'll always be there, and will always resurgence will always be there. So just wasting your time. So you might as well start standing up to that bully of belief. You might as well, which is what I did. I realized, hey, you know, might as well just go for it, and just, you know, have no choice. That's what I got to do. So I've continued to work on that and continue to work on that. It's still after me. It's still a bully. And if I give it a chance, of course, it will really, really go after me. But now it's a little scared of me, you know, because it's feeling threatened, you know. Threatened by certainty, saying, hey, you know, get away from that certainty, get away from it, get away from it. Belief believes that certainty is like the devil, you know, it's like complete disaster, it's your annihilation, and tells you at all costs, don't open that door, don't go behind that curtain, you're going to be annihilated, and it believes that, it really does, 100% believes that, it really believes it. What'll happen is eventually you choose a new idea, belief won't arise. But belief believes you're a child of belief, so by belief not arising, belief believes you won't arise either, you'll be annihilated. That's what it believes. So of course it's going to try and whatever it can do to get you away from belief. I mean, get you away from certainty, your attraction to certainty. It'll try everything it can do to get you away from your attraction to certainty. And if you continue to be attracted to certainty, it will just shake its head and just say, "Oh, this guy is really insane. You know, maybe it's terminal insanity." And you know, just look at it that way. Isn't that a pity? Oh, it'll pity you. Oh, I really pity that one. Terminal insanity. Can't do anything with that one. That one's going to be annihilated. And it'll hold out some hope, you know, but I don't know. I'm not holding out much hope for that one. It's going to be annihilated. Of course, totally false. Totally false. You're going to realize that reality cannot be annihilated. What you are cannot be annihilated, cannot even be touched, cannot be harmed, cannot be changed. You'll realize your perfect inclusion within reality. That's what you will realize. But of course, as long as we place any referencing a belief, we'll be uncertain about that, a little uncertain about it. But we can become more and more, gravitate more and more towards certainty. Which step two helps us really gravitate towards certainty. Disengage from belief. Gravitate towards certainty. Step two is very rapid progress that way. Step one is slower progress. It's slow, very gradual, slow inquiry, kind of slow, gradual. Step two, rapid. Not a long, drawn-out situation at all. Step two is not some long, drawn-out process. So if you're tired of the path, you know, oh, you're so tired of it, you think, step two, there's another step? Oh, no, I don't want that. It's take too long. No, it doesn't take long. Won't take long. If you've done the step one, done the inquiry, and step two won't take long at all. And you'll enjoy it. You know, you say, it's okay. It doesn't have to happen right now. This is wonderful. This is great. Love it. Love this gravitation towards certainty. Wonderful trip. Fantastic. You'll enjoy it. So you don't want to say, oh, it's got to stop right now. I want it to finish. No, you say, oh, if it, you know, however long it takes is fine with me. It doesn't matter one way or the other. It's just very, very great. Very enjoyable. Whereas step one, where we're still getting bullied. No, we want to get out of that bullying as fast as possible. But it's not so easy because we keep trying, thinking that we need to convince belief. And so we keep engaging belief, and then belief keeps bullying us. That's what happens, a vicious thing. The more we engage belief, the more belief will bully us away from our attraction to certainty. That's how it works. The less we engage with belief, the less we get bullied. The more we gravitate towards certainty. That's a positive spiral. So satsang brings about this positive spiral, inquiry, positive spiral. We find we're getting, wow, you know, we're really getting more and more gravitating towards certainty and less bullied by belief. We actually experience that. It's a fact. That's what I've experienced. It's a fact. Belief still tries to bully me, sure. I'm able to handle it a little better. Put it off, put it on hold. Don't react to it. Don't try to convince it of anything. If you have to do something, just do it, you know. Don't engage with belief trying to convince it of anything. Don't try to convince belief of anything. Don't try to be convincer. Because belief, again, cannot believe in facts. It's a rejection of facts. Belief is essentially a denial, attempt to reject facts, a fact. The facts of reality, the only facts there are. It's an attempt to deny those facts and say that they're changeable. So, of course, it cannot accept facts, so you can't convince it. So you just, you know, you have to put up with, as you're in this world, you put up with belief and but try not to keep trying to disengage, but in a nice way, in a polite way. It's frustrating because belief will keep coming at you. You just have to keep disengaging. And it's possible. It's very possible. Prepare for step two. And what do I do before step two? I just keep preparing for step two. That's all. That is all. Whether that's internal or external, or both. preparing for that experiencing of certainty in an ongoing way. In an ongoing way. Internally is more powerful than external. That is true. But external can lead to the internal, you see. What happens internally, it's so direct that we jump back from it and say, whoa, you know, very potent. And it's difficult for most to stay with that in inner certainty. Whereas external, at least there's the possibility of moving away from that external, distancing yourself a little bit. So you can kind of play with it a little bit and get used to it. And then that'll lead to the internal certainty. But going straight to internal certainty, it's certainly possible. Yeah, it is possible to do that. And maybe some have done it. Maybe. But it's more difficult. It is more difficult. But we do need to attempt it, to keep going towards that, because ultimately that is the ultimate goal, is certainty coming from within. There's no distancing at all. There's no process. There's no distancing, zero. There's nothing external required at all for that. But some spend a lifetime at that and maybe have a glimpse of or two of certainty. You know, that's not enough. It's better if there's an external source of that certainty and you can abide in that vibe, that certainty. You know, for hours and hours, days and days, that kind of thing. That is really profound. That'll really move you forward. In the meantime, we do everything we can to clarify and go towards that inner certainty. Choose a new idea, the idea of not trying to be prime creator. We keep trying. Maybe one day the certainty will arise for us, and we'll just abide in it. It's very possible. That can happen. And so we continue on with step one. Continue on with step one. Getting better and better and better, moving the narrative along, as this video here has done. It has moved it along significantly. We continue with that. Gathering our attention into this and getting that comfort with it, comfort with this, maximizing our time here, which is what this is all about here in this world. Maximize right use of time is super important. And by doing step one, inquiry, satsang, you're using your time in the right way, very, very effective way, getting ready for step two, abidance in certainty. With certainty, uncertainty. You're getting ready for that. And it will come. It will absolutely come. It has to come. There's not a vacuum. There's no vacuum. You know, when we put aside, you know, belief, that is filled up with being able to focus on our gravitating towards certainty. We continue to gravitate towards certainty. And at some point that will, you know, have its moment, and the gravitation will become more, and it'll become more, and we'll realize that we are really, you know, really engaging with this gravitating towards certainty, and that will become more and more and more, and ultimately the goal will be reached. It will be reached. All right, very great. We've moved things along here quite a bit, and we're going to end this video now. That's it for this one.